Okay, so here we start a new lecture again with a new topic altogether. So in the last lecture we discussed another class of electroceramics, which is rather more exotic in nature and something whose properties have created a lot of interest in the research community over decades, and that was superconducting ceramics. So we started with fundamentals of superconductivity, why superconductivity exists, what is superconductivity, what are the things which lead to the superconductivity, and we saw that superconductors were typically two different kind of superconductors, type 1 and type 2. And early generation superconductors were mostly either metals or metallic alloys, and they had TCs well below 30 Kelvin, and that was not very helpful because in order to use any superconductor you have to go to liquid helium, and liquid helium is being expensive. They don't make a cut towards practical technologies. Now the real revolution came in 1986 when Bednarz and Muller discovered cuprate oxides having superconductivity at higher temperatures, about 40 Kelvin or so. And then this led to a lot of flurry of activities in superconducting research, especially using cuprate oxides. And then soon after yttrium barium copper oxide was discovered, which had a TC of 92 Kelvin. And this was a remarkable discovery because it allowed people to transition from liquid helium to liquid nitrogen, and this was a major leap in the superconducting search, and this made commercial sense as well because liquid nitrogen is a lot cheaper than liquid helium. And then variety of other materials were discovered having higher TC than YBCO, but eventually YBCO remained choice of material simply because of its ease of fabrication and its rather uncomplicated nature as compared to other materials. And there are some applications which have emerged on the basis of the superconductors. For instance, your magnetically levitated trains, which work on the principle of repulsion of magnetic field. So as a result, the train floats in the rail tracks, and there the superconductors, which in superconducting state expel the magnetic field, which is analogous to diamagnetic effect, but it's not diamagnetic effect. And it helps in moving the train rather frictionless, in a frictionless manner. And then we talked about another use, that was MRI imaging, and that is again based on superconductors. And there are some other applications which are coming up, such as superconducting tapes and wires, which will of course operate at lower temperatures, but they will have zero resistance. Now, another class of materials in the similar league is which have been researched for about 10 years or so quite significantly, and these materials are called as multifroic and magnetoelectric materials. Now we know what is a ferroic material. Now a ferroic material is a material which has ferroelectric ordering. Now, ferroelectric ordering, of course, it's nothing but coupling of polarization and electric field. So you have polarization versus electric field plot. When you switch a ferroelectric material, then you have ferroelectric ordering. Ferromagnetic ordering. I'm just being a little stupid here. Ferromagnetic ordering, now which has a coupling between order parameters like magnetization and magnetic field. And then you of course have ferroelastic ordering, which is nothing but coupling between stress and strain. So these three ordering states individually are called as ferroic orderings, or materials which consist of these ordering are called as ferroic materials. Now naturally a multiferroic material is a material which has more than one of these ordering present. So a multiferroic material would be a material which has either of these two ordering states present simultaneously in the single phase. Okay. So So this is a multifluoric material. So multifluoric material would be defined as simultaneous presence of two or more ferroic ordering in single phase. Now, this is something, as you can understand, it's a very it's a rare phenomena. But it's a very exciting phenomena because it gives rise to tunability of devices by more than one or two, more than one stimuli. So, for a multiferroic, for instance, if it is ferromagnetic and ferroelectric in nature, it can allow tuning of devices by application of both electric and magnetic field, and both polarization and magnetization could be controlled by applying magnetic or electric field. So, there is some interdependence of properties. There is some sort of interplay of properties, and that allows multi-dimensional devices. You can have multi-state memory elements, you can have spintronic devices, etc., etc. So this has opened a flurry of activities to discover materials which are workable at room temperature, which could be used in these coveted applications. So these are three different kind of orderings which exist in materials. Another ordering which you could think is which has been recently coined is ferro toroidic ordering, which has also been thought to exist in these materials. Now another class. So this is magnetoelectric, multiferroic, and then you have magnetoelectric. Now, magnetoelectric is a little bit more general than multiferroic, because magnetoelectric is simply dependence of you do not need to have a ferroic material for this purpose, but all you need is dependence of magnetic and electrical properties on each other. Whereas in multiferroic, you would require both the ordering states to be present, but it does not mean that they are very strongly coupled with respect to each other. So, here magnetoelectric is essentially, it is a more sort of, I would say, a general phenomenon, and this is and does not necessarily require ferroic ordering states in the material. All you require is material should be magnetically and electrically polarizable, and there should be interdependence. So, for instance, you can have a paramagnetic, you can have a material which is paraelectric and ferromagnetic, and here the properties of this material can be, you know, mediated by something like strain. So, you do not really require direct coupling. There could be indirect coupling of these properties through some other order parameters such as strain. So, essentially these two effects have allowed researchers to think of variety of devices which could come up if these materials were successfully designed and fabricated, and this would allow the development of you know, a completely new array of devices, for instance memory, sensors and spin walls, etc. So, what we are going to do is that we are going to discuss the fundamental aspects of these two materials, and then we look at some of the candidate materials which are being researched at present. So, the problem is especially with multiferroics, most of them are not naturally occurring. So, as a result, the availability is limited. So, most of them are fabricated in laboratory. On top of that, even if you make them in laboratory based on variety of considerations, there are not many materials which show effect. There is very limited number of materials show this effect. So, as a result, your choice of materials is severely limited, and there are other problems with respect to their fabrication as well as the transition temperatures they show, which are often not workable near the room temperature, or fabrication could be quite tricky to obtain a single phase. Often they come up with many impurities, and this sort of this makes the life of difficult researchers quite difficult in order to use them in any useful application. So, we will just first discuss the basic aspects of multiferroic and magnetoelectric systems. So, we'll discuss the general features. Now, general features, of course, multiferroic materials must have more than one ferroic odd ring. In single phase, this is the true definition of a multiferroic material. Another is, so which means you should have either ferroelectricity or ferromagnetism, basically ferromagnetic odd ring, ferroelectric and magnetic odd ring, or ferroelectric and ferroelastic odd ring, or ferromagnetic and ferroelastic odd ring. Typically, preferable ones are from the electrical magnetic properties point of view are ferroelectric and magnetic odd ring. Should exist in single phase, because ferroelectric materials will anyway be piezoelectric. So, mechanical part is covered in there, and if you have magnetic restriction, that also becomes a part of it. And then you have, you know, critical temperature. So, both of these materials, both of these classes, multiferroics, if you have a ferroic ferroelectric ordering, if you have a magnetic ordering, then you have a critical temperature, and you also have to consider the symmetry of material. So, critical temperature versus symmetry, and whether the symmetry is preserved, whether the symmetry is broken, this has to be and then of course, you have other criteria such as whether the material is conducting or so on and so forth. So, some other criteria which we have a look at soon. A typical general guide to I to find out the magnetic and multiferroic and magnetoelectric materials is, so you draw variety of these circles. So, you have this, for example, one circle which you can refer to as materials which are electrically polarizable. Then you can have another circle of materials which could be, you know, called as magnetically polarizable, and anything in between. And then you can have something, you know, within this electrically polarizable, you can have a class which is ferroelectric. So, this is, you know, ferroelectric, and then I can have another class which can be, you know, ferromagnetic. And between these, I have, you know, anything, the common materials between ferroelectric and ferromagnetic are going to be this, these. And these are going to be, you know, your multiferroic. And then you have a class of materials which are these, and these are going to be your magnetoelectric. So, this is a general guide to I to define magnetoelectric and multiferroic materials. Okay. Now, before we go into further discussion, I will recommend certain papers and books for you to read, because there are no books on this topic as such, very good books. So, I would say recommended reading for beginners. And once you build up certain background, you can of course look at more papers. So recommended reading, for instance, would be a paper by very nice paper by Nicola Hill. This appeared in Journal of Physics and Chemistry B, and volume number is 104, page number is 66942, page 6709, and this appeared in 2000. And then we have a paper from Manfred Fiebig. This appeared in Journal of Physics D, Applied Physics, and this has a volume 38, page number R 123 to 152, and this appeared in 2005. And then third paper in this line is a paper by Wilma Ehrenstein and co-workers, who published in Nature, volume number 442, page number 759, and this appeared in 2006. And finally, there's another one by D. Chomsky in Physics Journal, volume 2, page 20, and 2009. So these are some of the papers which you can go through in order to get some fundamental understanding of this topic. And in this lecture, most of the content has been taken, basic content has been taken from these papers only. Okay, so before we go into the theory, we'll have a look at the historical perspective, historical preview. And here, multiferoic effect was discovered in, or magnetoelectric effect was magnetoelectric effect was discovered in 1888 by Röntgen, and in 1894 by Pierre Curie. And these were two independent studies which discovered magnetoelectric effect. Now, what Röntgen discovered was, he discovered in materials that a magnetic materials could be a material when placed in electric field was magnetized, and conversely, when they put it in magnetic field, it got polarized. So this was the discovery made by Röntgen. Pierre Curie made the discovery that he discovered the magnetoelectric effect in the material, which is effect essentially dependence of magnetic and electrical properties on each other based on symmetry considerations in material. So the two effects were observed independently and quite independently concluding studies. And the term magnetoelectric . So in both of these studies, they observed the effects, but they did not call this as a magnetoelectric effect, rather they just described the phenomenon. So the term magnetoelectric was used in 1926 by Debye. This was the first time when the term was used, and the first material to show this effect was chromium oxide. And this chromium oxide essentially it showed this small magnitudes of induced polarization as well as magnetization. So you can say small p and m, and after that there are flurry of activities and variety of other materials which were discovered to show, for example, Ti2O3, and gallium ferrite was again studied, and then boracites, phosphates, etc. Variety of these materials were studied for the magnetoelectric effect. As far as the multiferoics are concerned, the first multiferoic discovered was nickel boracite. Nickel iodine boracite, to be precise. with the formula Ni3B7O13I. So this was the first multiferroic which was discovered, and this was simultaneously ferroelectric and ferromagnetic. And subsequently there were many studies which were made on these compounds, however most of them had quite complex crystal structures and materials were not really very useful from the technological point of view because of small magnitudes of polarization, magnetization, as well as the Curie temperatures which were not handy. Now this sort of led to this research on variety of perovskite materials. Now, in case of perovskite materials, Russian scientists took a lead sort of. They discovered a lot of early generation perovskite materials. And here, what they did was in the perovskite material, this D0 cation which sits in the ideal perovskite structure at the center of the unit cell, this was replaced by a variety of iron. So, essentially their whole theory was based on replacement of D0 cation by Dn, partially filled d orbital cations, so cations with partially filled d orbitals in perovskite octahedra, and this was their basic philosophy, and this led to variety of compounds, and the compounds which were discovered first for such compounds were PbFeWO3, Fe here would be 1/3, W would be 2/3, and similarly another was PbMgWO3, and these would be half. So these were the two mixed perovskites which gave rise to simultaneous ferroelectricity and magnetic ordering. And here the ferroelectricity was caused by diamagnetic, these magnesium and tungsten ions, sorry, here it would be iron and magnesium, and the magnetic ordering was caused by this iron ion. So this was the basis of discovery of these materials. However, these materials were a little unsuccessful simply because of their limited, or rather I shall say low Curie temperature or Neel temperatures. So as a result, they did not prove really commercially attractive. And then subsequently the research focus, now this, even after this, lot of research was done on multiferroic and magnetoelectric materials, but the real breakthrough started coming in the beginning of this century when people started talking about these materials again, and these materials were now discovered in thin film form. And thin film form, somehow, just like it happened with ferroelectric materials, ferroelectric materials were early, in the early stages were studied in the bulk form, and in the bulk form their properties were somehow limited. But in subsequently, when with the advent of good deposition technologies, people started using them in thin film form of high quality, and then they started observing that properties can be significantly retained or enhanced in the thin film form if the thin films are of good quality. And same thing has happened with multiferroics. Nowadays we have fantastic techniques, as I'll discuss in the last lecture, which can give rise to rather defect free layers with very good chemical and structural integrity. And they can give rise to fantastic properties that we otherwise don't notice in the bulk form, simply because of the presence of defects like grain boundaries, etc. So in 2003, for instance, a paper was published in Science by a group of scientists from Maryland and Berkeley and other places as well, and they postulated a large ferroelectricity in a material called bismuth ferrite. And this bismuth ferrite has since then been researched massively. I mean, over the last 8 years, hundreds of papers, thousands of papers have appeared, many conferences have been held, and this has also led to massive research in magnetoelectric and multiferroic material. So this recent past decade has been spent mostly on understanding the structure property correlation in thin film multiferroics, along with of course bulk and single crystals as well. So I'll discuss these materials a little later. So first I'll talk about what is the requirement for a magnetoelectric and multiferroic material. So requirements from the point of view of physics. So the first requirement is first criteria that comes to our mind, or you can say requirements rather than criterion, for multiferroic materials. Now the first criterion that of course comes to our mind is symmetry, and and simply because and this is nothing but crystal symmetry, okay. And this comes to our mind because we know that ferroelectric materials are materials which don't have a center of symmetry. So ferroelectric materials are non-centrosymmetric, and this is a must requirement for ferroelectricity to prevail. On the other hand, there are 31 total out of 31 point groups, and out of 31 point groups you have, you know, the 11 point groups which are non-centrosymmetric and which show ferroelectricity, or which are polar, and some of them show ferroelectricity. Now according to calculations for simultaneous existence of ferroelectricity, ferroelectric and magnetic ordering, you require 13 point groups which can show both properties simultaneously. Now this is a large number. I mean, materials which belong to these 11 to 13 point groups, or let's say 11 point groups, they are very large in number. And out of these, you have, you know, a space group and point group, both of them together. So out of these 13 point groups, so total 13 point groups include variety of materials, and you can form variety of crystal structures. So this certainly cannot be a criterion, simply because the number of materials which belong to these point groups is very large. So it's probably unlikely that symmetry is going to play upon. So symmetry probably is unlikely criterion. And then another criteria that emerges is the conductivity. Conductivity has emerged as a criteria because ferroelectrics are typically, by definition, ferroelectrics are insulators, and most ferromagnets are conductors or semiconductors. Now this was thought as one of the criteria. However, there are some magnetic oxides which are which can be highly semiconducting, or maybe on the lower side of semiconductivity, which means having high resistivity, or insulators. So some of these can be insulating. So this is again thought out as not a very strict criteria. And another criteria is the nature of D ion. Now this D ion, in case of ferroelectric, you would require the D ion to be D0. In case of ferromagnet, you would require, so this is for ferroelectric and this is for ferromagnet. Now these two criterions are quite opposite in nature. So as a result, this criterion is something which puts a constraint on the system, and is kind of paradoxical in nature as well. So because of opposite requirement, so this is something which is not understood well. And then the other one you can say is mechanism. Of ferroelectricity. Now typically in ferroelectric materials like perovskite materials, you would assume the center of symmetry to be broken by movement of central ions in the octahedra. Now here in ferroelectrics, in multiferroics, this is not strictly maintained. So for instance, in bismuth ferrite, BiFeO3, so ordering of lone pair of electrons of, we can say lone pair of orbitals of bismuth 6s, lone pair of electrons of bismuth 6s orbital along 111 is responsible for ferroelectricity. It could be some other mechanism in other materials as well. For example, a TBMN-205, which is another class of multifluoric materials. In TBMN-205, it's the charge ordering which allows the ferroelectricity to occur. So, as we can see here, the phenomena of ferroelectricity is not now limited to only central displacement of central B ion in perovskites, but rather it could be anything else as well, such as charge ordering here. Similarly, in YMnO3, the tilting of polyhedra, you don't have MnO6, rather you have MnO5 polyhedra. So, in case of YMnO3, so tilting of MnO5 polyhedra is responsible for ferroelectricity. So, the reasons for ferroelectricity now have become different as opposed to what we had in simple ABO3 structure. So, as a result, there are a variety of mechanisms now for ferroelectricity as against a real normal ferroelectric. Another criteria which was considered was size of D ion. Now, this is not a very valid criteria simply because there are a variety of materials with variety of sizes of D ions which show both effects. So, not a very valid criteria. And then you had structure distortion. This is something which is interesting because in ferromagnetic material, because in ferroelectrics you require, when you cool across Curie temperature, you have this distortion from high symmetry phase to a low symmetry phase when you cool it down, and this low symmetry phase does not have a center of symmetry. As a result, your material is ferroelectric. In case of your symmetry has to be, center of symmetry has to be broken. In case of ferromagnetic material, when you are in ferromagnetic state, you have a Jahn-Teller distortion. This Jahn-Teller distortion requires that center of symmetry is maintained. So, this is this paradoxical or conflicting requirement of structure distortion in both of these materials. So, ferroelectrics will have low symmetry phase below TC, and this requires breaking off in center of symmetry, and ferromagnets have Jahn, I am talking about oxides only. So, here we are talking in the context of ceramic materials, not in the context of metals, and this requires, so these two are opposite requirements, because Jahn-Teller distortion requires center of symmetry to be maintained and low symmetry phase requires center of symmetry to be broken. So, as a result you have conflicting requirements. So, this is something which is interesting. Another, and so these are few criterions which have been proposed for these ferroelectric and magnetic ordering for simultaneous existence of these. So, there is no as such, you can say, a concise theory which gives rise to a concise set of criterion. There are a variety of set of criterion which are followed in variety of materials. So, we do not have a clear agreement at the moment by researchers on these. So at the moment it's a topic of, let us say, debate or research. Now, as far as magnetoelectric coupling in these materials is concerned, since you have these two properties occurring simultaneously, you have coupling of these two properties, and this has been given by Landau expression. So, you can write an expression for free energy in terms of electric and magnetic field. So, this would be equal to FEH will be equal to F naught minus EI and then minus of MISHI. So, you have two terms for polarization, magnetic field dependence, linear dependence, and then you have minus of epsilon naught epsilon ij ei ej minus of half mu naught into mu ij hi hj. So these are again third and fourth term. So these two terms are linear dependence of polarization, temperature dependent, basically polarization, magnetization depending upon electric magnetic field as well. And then you have these two terms. So you have temperature dependent terms for purely magnetization and polarization, and then you have these fourth and fifth terms which are essentially effect of H and E on P and M through, now they are, because you have this permeability and susceptibility in that. So these are temperature dependent terms, effect of, and then you have what is called as a minus alpha ij ei hj. So this is the magneto-electric term. So interdependence of magnetic and electrical parameters, and then you have higher order terms beta ij k by 2 ei hj hk plus half of gamma ij k hi ej ek and so on and so forth. So all these terms here on the right, they are all higher order terms, higher order coupling terms, and these could be, you know, about they could be third rank tensors. What is of importance here is this linear term, linear magnetoelectric coupling term here, which is this alpha ij, and this is called as linear magnetoelectric coupling coefficient. And if you, so naturally you can get polarization and magnetization from these terms by just differentiating these equations with respect to electric field and magnetic field. So what you have alpha ij here is, it's called as linear magnetoelectric coupling coefficient, and we are fortunate that most of the materials show this linear magnetoelectric coupling, which basically quantifies the dependence of magnetization on electric field or dependence of polarization on magnetic field. And and by and large, we are quite fortunate that most materials show linear effects. Now, so this is called as direct coupling. Then you have indirect coupling as well. Then indirect coupling is essentially can be mediated by some other order parameter, such as by strain. And this is strain, and this has been shown in variety of systems like europium titanate and strontium manganite, where a strain can couple these two order parameters in a single phase. As far as the measurement of these techniques are concerned, you can measure them indirectly, including, for instance, you can measure the polarization, magnetization versus temperature measurement and notice the fluctuation dielectric properties near the magnetic transition, or vice versa, you do the dielectric constant versus temperature measurement and notice the fluctuation in the magnetization near transition temperature. So this is indirect measurement. Direct measurement include directly measuring the response of material magnetic or electric response of material in response to applied electric and magnetic field. So these are, this is sort of fundamental background of magnetoelectric multiferroic material. Now we will look at some of the materials in question. So this is the fundamental of multiferroic materials and magnetoelectric materials. So just to have a summary at this point, magnetoelectric materials are of course the materials which have interdependence of magnetic and electrical properties. It doesn't require materials necessarily to be ferroelectric and ferromagnetic. In contrast, multiferroic materials is a state of materials where you have to have simultaneous existence of these two order parameters, either ferroelectric, ferromagnetic, or ferromagnetic, ferroelastic, and so, or ferroelastic and ferroelectric. So this requires variety of criterions, as we discussed. Some of these criterions are quite conflicting in nature, some of these criterions do not work very well. So essentially, as we would say at the moment, there is no well established theory of multiferroic effect as to what makes material show a multiferroic effect. And then as far as multiferroic effects, multiferroic materials are concerned, there are two types of multiferroic materials. And another thing that is of interest is, just to deviate, that is of interest is this alpha ij term. And this alpha ij is the linear magnetoelectric coefficient. Given that you have ferroic and two ferroic orderings present, ferroelectric and magnetic ordering, you have interdependence of magnetic and electrical order parameters, and this can be quite well characterized by this calculation of or measurement of this alpha ij. And this alpha ij can be measured indirectly or directly, and indirect measurements include the observation of properties near the transition temperatures, or you can say observation of magnetic or electrical properties near the electrical and magnetic transition temperatures, and direct measurement of course require direct observations of the coupling. Multiferroic materials are further classified in two classes. So, one is type 1 multiferroic and another is type 2 multiferroic. Now, in case of type 1 multiferroic, you have these two effects, these two ordering states present independently of each other. So, two orderings present independently of each other. And as a result, they have weak coupling of properties. In case of type 2 magnetism, it's the type 2 magnetism essentially are the materials which have, you know, where the in many cases the magnetism in the material is thought to give rise to ferroelectricity. So, this is something which is a very interesting phenomenon. So, as we'll see in the coming slides. So, here in type 2 multiferroics, what you have is ferroelectricity origin is tied to magnetism. And examples here are materials like BiFeO3 are type 1 and materials like TbMn2O5 are type 2 kind of materials. Now, these the type 1 multiferroics typically have large polarization and type 2 multiferroics have typically have a small polarization. So, this is the difference between these two different kinds of multiferroics. So, what we will do is that now we'll take example of some of the multiferroic materials. So, we'll take examples of only a few of them. So, we'll take in case of type 1, we will take example of BiFeO3, BiMnO3 and some hexagonal manganites. And then we will move on to the next part. So, we will start with BiFeO3, which is also called as bismuth iron oxide or bismuth ferrite. Now, this is one of the most studied ferroelectric multiferroic materials. Earlier BiFeO3 was of course discovered by a lot of Russians in 50s and 60s, but 2003 marked the year when a paper in Science, which is whose details are 1719 page 2003, a paper in Science sparked massive interest in this material because the material showed large polarization of about 50 microcoulomb per centimeter square and magnetization. Now, this discovery was true to some extent because the polarization which was reported was indeed true, but the magnetization which was reported was not true, and later it was worked out that this magnetization was because of impurities in the material. However, this material BIFU3 is very exciting because of large polarization, and one can work his way around in terms of magnetization by tuning the material by doping it with certain chemical substituents which can promote magnetic moments. Or now why we'll look at the basic characteristics first, and then we'll go into what can be done to tune this material. So this material has high TC of around 1100 K, which is ferroelectric TC, and reasonably high TN, which is of around 650 Kelvin. And this is an antiferromagnet with canted spins. Now these canted spins are spiral in nature, so as a result, typically as we discussed in antiferromagnetism, your spins are not perfectly antiparallel, rather they are little bit inclined with respect to each other. So as a result, you would expect some magnetism, but because of periodicity of these spins, which is called as G type, and this is a G type antiferromagnet, there are variety of antiferromagnets depending upon the antiparallelness, whether it's antiparallel in planes, whether it's antiparallel in sides. So this is called a G type antiferromagnet, and this gives rise to a very small magnetic moment in the material. And there are strategies which can be used to, so you have a spiral spin structure of G type antiferromagnetic structure. However, this can be broken down by some methods, and this material has a rhombohedral structure. So the structure of this material is something like, I'll show you in a different slide. So this is the structure of this material. So what you have here is these bigger ions are, you know, bismuth ions. So these are your bismuth ions, as written there. These are iron ions, and these are oxygen atoms. So this is a rhombohedral structure with a space group R3C, and this structure changes to, of course, high symmetry phase up after the Curie temperature when you heat this material. So these are the crystallographic aspects of this material. So we can write here BIFeO3 has a R3C structure, and these are the general parameters of this material. Now, as I told you that in thin film form, this material has been shown to predict high polarization, but the magnetization which was predicted in that study was found to be later wrong because the authors did not notice the presence of impurities. However, the material, making this material is not easy. So although it has large PR in both thin film and bulk single crystal state, the leakage is high, and leakage could be high because of defects, it could be because of impurities, it could be because of grain boundaries. So as a result, making this material is not easy. So one has to be really careful in making this material in good quality, and if you can control the magnetic impurity formation precisely, then in pure form the magnetic moment is negligible. So in order to induce the magnetic moment, and this typically, this if you see magnetic moment, then this is because of, you know, Fe2 plus Fe3 plus valence fluctuations. You can have Fe2O3 kind of impurities, gamma Fe2O3 or alpha Fe2O3 or Fe3O4. So any iron containing impurities which is magnetic in nature can give rise to the observed magnetism in this material. Now this material can be tuned by variety of things. So doping at A and B site can be one of the factors to induce certain properties in this material. So for instance, you can dope it by A site substituents like barium or neodymium or lanthanum, or B site substitutes like zirconium, titanium, etc. And these have been reported in the literature to exhibit a result in improved or changed properties in terms of both electrical and magnetic properties. So there are a variety of, so this structure is one of the most well studied structure. You can have a look at a variety of journals and literature to find about this material more. I'll not give you all the studies, but all I have done is I have given you the general features of this material, and this is indeed a very well studied system in terms of properties, simply because of its attractive high Curie temperatures and Néel temperatures, which make this material very attractive. Another class of material in this category is called as bismuth manganite. And this bismuth manganite is again a multifroic materials. It is a low temperature ferromagnet and a room temperature ferroelectric, and it shows magnetic ordering below 105 K, and ferroelectric TC happens around 770 K. The crystal structure of this material is monoclinic in nature, and this monoclinic changes to orthorhombic structure at about 770 K, and below monoclinic you have another low symmetry phase, which is triclinic. And this material basically has ferroelectricity because of orbital ordering of manganese ions. So this is responsible for ferroelectricity or ferroelectric distortion in this material. The problem with this material is this is highly leaky. So it's really difficult to make this material in a resistive form, because in order to have a ferroelectric effect, you have to have high insulation. And this is somehow has been a problem with this material. There are some studies recently which have reported high resistance in this material in the thin film form, but that again depends upon group to group and paper to paper. However, there are strategies which can be adopted to make this material more resistive. And then you have another class of materials, which is hexagonal manganites. And these hexagonal manganites are typically called as RMnO3 kind of materials, and examples of these are YMnO3, TbMnO3, etc. Variety of these materials. So R is, you can say, typically a rare earth ion, and these are all manganites structured. So you have a hexagonal structure here. I'll again show you the hexagonal structure. So this is the hexagonal structure based on yttrium manganese oxide. So you have here, this is the MnO5 polyhedra. Now here notice, unlike AbO3 perovskite structure, which is cubic in nature, you have MnO5, so you have MnO5 polyhedra. So instead of having 6-fold coordination, you have a 5-fold coordination of manganese. Similarly, the R ion, not bismuth, the R ion has a 7-fold coordination. So this coordination is different as compared to AbO3 structure, and you can say this is the hexagonal unit cell, and you have these layers of manganese oxides followed by yttrium oxides followed by manganese oxide. So it's layered kind of structure which you have here. Here these materials, you can have holonium manganite as well, you can have YBMnO3, variety of these materials are possible. So and they have hexagonal structure with a space group of P63Cm. This is the space group of these materials. So here, as I have shown you the crystal structure, you have difference in coordination. Now this, the polyhedra which you have, MnO5 polyhedra, the distortion of these polyhedra is responsible for ferroelectricity in these materials. So again, the mechanism of ferroelectricity is because of polyhedral distortion of MnO5. So this is the difference here you have with respect to other cubic sort of pseudo cubic structures. Now, the advantage with these materials is that they have high ferroelectric transition temperatures, so typically higher than 500 K. However, Neel temperature is too low, and this is what makes results in these materials not being very useful for practical applications. Now, I'll show you some materials examples. So, for example, why MnO3 has a TN of about 80 Kelvin and TC of 920 Kelvin, and this has mu effective, you can say 8.9, and polarization in micro coulomb per centimeter square, this is 5.5, not too bad. Similarly, you have HOMnO3, holonium magnite, and this has 76, 873, 11.1 and 5.6. Similarly, you can have LUMnO3, this has 96, greater than 750, 5.2 and 7.5. So, by tuning the composition, you can tune these temperatures as well as the properties. Now, finally, another class of material, as we said, is type 2 multifroics. And here we will not go in great detail, because here ferroelectricity is tied with respect to magnetic structure of these materials. So, having a magnetically ordered state is very important, but you have a very strong coupling between ferroelectric and magnetic ordering. And so, examples of these materials are Tb Mn2O5, Tb MnO3. Tb MnO3 belongs to this class, not to the type 1 class. So, here I should make a change here. So, not Tb MnO3, this should be type, it is a hexagonal material, but it is type 2. So, in that sense, hexagonal is common to both of these classes. So, you have and then you have MnWO6, variety of these materials, and these materials have different reasons for ferroelectricity, which we will not go into detail, but these are the examples of type 2 multiferroics, which have a strong coupling of ferroelectric and magnetic property, but they have low PR of the order of nano coulombs per centimeter square. So, about 2 or 3 orders of magnitude smaller as compared to normal multiferroics. Finally, what we have is a two-phase structure systems, now two-phase of course are artificially made, they are not in single phase. So, for instance, materials like barium titanate, which is a ferroelectric, can be mixed with a ferrimagnet like cobalt ferrite, and these two when mixed with each other, they give rise to coupling through the interface between these two phases, and they have they show magnetoelectric coupling. So, of course, you do not have two properties in the same phase, but you artificially put them together and then create an interface, and which gives rise to coupling between these two properties. And there are variety of these materials, barium titanate, cobalt ferrite, you can have PZT plus COFe2O4. And then BiFeO3 plus COFe2O4. So, variety of these structures are possible, and which have different coupling constants, and coupling constants vary from 50 to 5000. So, you would say alpha ij, this would vary from millivolt per centimeter oisted. So, variety of these systems can be made artificially. So, we'll stop. So, this is the end of this module. In summary, what we have discussed here is, so I'll just summarize this here. In summary, you have fantastic effects like, you know, multiferroic and magnetoelectric effects. Multiferroic materials can be magnetoelectric, but magnetoelectric materials are not necessarily multiferroic. For multiferroic materials, you need to have simultaneous existence of ferroelectric and magnetic ordering. Unfortunately, these materials are not very commonly available, they are very rare. So, as a result, a lot of effort has been put in research and development in developing these materials in laboratories. There is no well understood physics of these materials as to is there a unified theory which says that okay, these materials are multiferroic, these are not. So, this is not a very well established phenomena in terms of physics as yet. However, research has been carried out on a variety of materials with a lot of emphasis on materials like bismuth ferrite and some emphasis on other class of materials like bismuth manganite, terbium manganite, yttrium manganite, etc. And of course, artificially structured materials like composites have developed as well, where you don't have multiferrosity in single phase, but you can create artificial multiferrosity by mixing these two phases, and through interface mediation you can create this multiferroic effect or magnetoelectric effect. So, we'll stop this lecture here. What I have done is I have basically introduced to you a new topic. So, multiferroic magnetoelectric effect, type 1 and 2 multiferroics, materials like BiFeO3, BiMnO3, YMnO3. So, I have introduced you to these materials, and then you have composites like barium titanate and cobalt ferrite. So, this is, you know, single phase system, and this is your two phase or multi phase system. So, so this is the end of this lecture. So, this is probably we are nearing the end of this module. In the next module, we will take up the preparation methods of these electroceramics in general, and then we will finish this module. Thank you.